Let's check in on the race to the White House. Joining me live now is Brendan O'Connor, Associate Professor at the US Studies Centre. Thanks for your time. It was a very different Democratic convention. No people, of course, because of COVID-19. Look, a lot has been spoken about Donald Trump and fewer numbers at his rallies and the impact there. But what about the impact on Joe Biden trying to make a big splash, you know, really firing the starter's gun on his campaign?
Well, as you say, Tom, it's a bit disappointing that there isn't those excited partisans at these rallies and the convention throwing balloons in the air and seemingly clapping at any announcement. So that is part of the pageantry of American politics that I think some of us miss. It doesn't always play well in the rest of the world where it looks a bit overdone, but it leads to a flatness of the current convention because we're used to conventions being such rowdy, enthusiastic events that it's hard not to watching a convention on Zoom and think, oh, well, that isn't that exciting. That's rather dull. And, you know, how is anyone going to stick with this for 4 days? So it is a challenge. Most people, I think, will just watch snippets of it on their, you know, Facebook feed or maybe on the comedy channels. But it still has to go ahead. It's an important event and it's a way of announcing, you know, some of the ideas the party has and certainly, you know, keeping the name Kamala Harris in the spotlight, showing the sort of unity of the Democratic Party, as you saw yesterday.
Now, apologies for before and apologies for putting our viewers through this question yet again. It's to do with Michelle Obama's speech. She was once quoted as saying, well, they go low, we go high. Is there a sense, apart from this speech and just the brawl that's going to start now, that everyone's going to go low in this campaign?
Well, I think her sentiment is the right one, that in given the numbers of people dying of COVID in the United States, I think you've got to start from empathy and work to politics, that you shouldn't start with politics. I think she gave that sort of human face of the Democratic Party, you know, a good sort of image. She did well in her speech. You know, it's hard, I think, doing interviews like this or talking on Zoom or on Skype, you know, it doesn't come across with the energy of a convention. So I think she tried to send that message out. Inevitably, there is a negativity, though, because the election on the Democrat side will be about Trump, that it's not so. We only saw really Bernie Sanders of all the speakers putting forward policy. The campaign that the Democrats are going to run is not that different to last time. It's Trump isn't fit for office. We've got a record now. Judge him on his record. So that makes it a negative campaign. Trump will also be, I think, going after Joe Biden very hard. So, you know, there's going to be this focus, as there often is with American elections, on the leaders and on negativity.
One of the more interesting addresses at this convention didn't come from a politician or a celebrity, but the daughter of a Trump supporter. This woman said that her father was a big Trump supporter, listened to what he had to say initially about COVID-19, that it wasn't a big threat, even with people with underlying health conditions would mostly be okay. The father went out to a karaoke session with some friends, contracted the virus and died within 5 days. So this was her warning, if you like, and mentioning, you know, Trump supporters might have dropped off him. Do you think this is something that will resonate, that they're going to be able to peel many of Donald Trump supporters away from him?
Well, you see it in the polls that elderly Americans who particularly tend to be very strong for the Republican Party, people who are post sort of 65 years, they're turning more to the Democrats than we've seen for a long time. So I think people who think about the virus more, and of course, the older you get, the more you probably have to think and worry about it, unfortunately, those people, I think, are shy about voting for Trump. There was, I think, in the convention, a real attempt bringing John Kasich on to say, look, people who typically don't take the Democratic Party seriously or vote for them are giving them a look because of Donald Trump. So that was a part of a fairly deliberate strategy of hearing from Trump, past Trump voters, hearing from Republicans, people saying, look, this is an extraordinary president, extraordinary times, and you might want to give the opposition party a look this time round. And that probably is a strategy aimed more at independents, people who are neither Democrats or Republicans, because as we've seen in the past, Republicans tend to be pretty loyal to their party, as Democrats do, at a rate of around 85% or 90% of them tend to vote for the presidential candidate, no matter who it is.
We've got as well Republicans on Democratic turf, if you want. Saw this video, apologies, I've got the pronunciation incorrect, Kimberly Klasick, is K-L-A-C-I-K. She's a Republican that in this video, it's been viewed 4.9 million times, walks through Baltimore and says, Democrat-run cities, here's the reality of them. They don't want you to see this. This is obviously an attempt to say that, well, this issue of Black Lives Matter isn't one that should all run against Donald Trump. There's a law and order matter here as well she's trying to highlight. How effective could this be?
That was one of the reasons that Biden chose Kamala Harris. I mean, Harris was a district attorney, then attorney general for the state of California. She's, you know, got a tough record in some regards as a prosecutor. That's her role, putting people in jail. Some of the cases that some people think she should have argued for more lenient sentencing, she didn't always. She supported a degree of reform, but she's a moderate. She's certainly not a radical on these issues, on her record at least. And so I think that tries to neutralize what I think will be Trump's kind of strong kind of push to put law and order at the front of his campaign. We've seen a bit of that in his rhetoric. So how effective the Democrats are at neutralizing that issue, whether people think, well, Trump has used these scare tactics to get elected, particularly with the border wall and immigration, and they're not going to work again. I think that is going to be one of the big issues of the election to watch out for. It's a playbook out of Richard Nixon's sort of strategy from the 1970s of focusing on law and order, but whether it will work or not, and given that I think the pandemic, COVID will just be so much of the central issue that I think it will be hard for Trump to promote that as a dominant issue in the campaign.
Really interesting figures out today on postal vote. That Biden voters are 4-1 more likely to vote via post in the coming election. I mean, this goes to how huge this issue could be. Donald Trump, of course, trying to undermine postal votes, talking of voter fraud and so on.
It's a huge issue. I mean, we shouldn't be talking about it in a democracy. You should be wanting to encourage everyone to vote. The Australian system has some merits, definitely in that regard. And so the idea that you would make it difficult for people to vote through trickery and through corruption is an anathema to should be to the United States, to democratic principles. It's more likely, I think, Democrats will want a postal vote because they tend to live in more condensed areas, less likely to live in spread out areas in the suburbs or in rural America. So it makes sense on that regard. But it is a big issue, and I think one that we've rightly focusing on, because anything that undermines the democratic process isn't just bad for America. It's, I think, bad for democracies in general. So that is something I think a lot of the international attention will be on in the coming weeks.
Yeah, it's going to be massive, whatever way this falls, you'd imagine. Brendan O'Connor, thanks for your time today.
My pleasure.